नमस्कार, आप सभी का आई सपोर्ट नरेंद्र मोदी द्वारा आयोजित नमो कनेक्ट में स्वागत है। वेलकम फ्रेंड्स टू नमो कनेक्ट, एन इनिशिएटिव बाय आई सपोर्ट नरेंद्र मोदी प्लेटफॉर्म। टुडे वी हैव विद अस, आज हमारे साथ हैं श्री सुधांशु त्रिवेदी। टुडे वी हैव विद अस डॉक्टर सुधांशु त्रिवेदी, हु इज द नेशनल स्पोक्स पर्सन ऑफ द बीजेपी। वी विल बी टेकिंग योर क्वेश्चंस। We'll also be taking some questions on from Facebook, Twitter, and other online platforms. And I would first like to request Dr. Sudhanshu Trivedi to say a few words about himself.
As far as me is concerned, I am basically a student of mechanical engineering. I have done PhD in mechanical engineering, and I remain assistant professor of mechanical engineering in three universities, and I remain associated with RSS from my school days. Then subsequently, at one point of time, I became editor of a news magazine in Lucknow. Then subsequently, I came in touch with BJP. And in 2000, I became information advisor to CMUT. And going through the various positions in BJP and also in the government of Uttar Pradesh and the central government, in 2005 and 6, I remained political advisor to the party president of BJP. Right now, along with that, I am also the nationalist.
Dr. Trivedi, we would like to have first question from Kiran Nayak. Kiranji, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Hi, Mr. Trivedi. This is Kiran Nayak, real estate investor from Mumbai. I'm happy to see that this time we are 1 month away from Mr. Modi becoming Prime Minister, which we've been all waiting for a long time. My question has to do more with something that I didn't see very detailedly in your manifesto, which has to do with our military forces. As far as military was concerned in the UPA government, we saw that it was neglected a bit, and in the last 6 months we had 4 submarine mishaps, 2 ship explosions, C-130J which was brand new crash into the riverbed there somewhere, and then the Su-30 MK-1 crash again, which was also another new fighter jet. So I wanted to know what would be BJP's policies towards purchase of new equipment, because some of these purchases take so long. It takes 6 to 10 years for the ministry to purchase these things. And by the time they actually purchase this stuff, it's already outdated in most parts of the world. So when a nationalist government like yours comes in, I wanted to know if you will take steps to streamline the purchases, maybe make it limited in 6 months' time or a year's time, to make sure that we get the best defense equipment for armed forces, especially with Russia taking Crimea now and nobody else getting involved. We have to be sure that we are well protected. So my question was for the BJP policy regarding the defense of India.
There are two types of solutions for the problem you have said. One is the immediate solution, another is the long-term solution. The immediate solution can be to, as you have suggested, to streamline the purchasing process and go for as far as transparency is possible in this, because so many questions have been raised on defense deal during the last 20 years or so. And the second thing is the long-term process. The long-term process, it is ironical that a great country like India, after the independence of 67 years, we are not having any defense production unit. If we can manufacture satellite and missiles and other things, why we cannot manufacture a certain level of defense equipment and machinery? So, BJP, when we will come into power, along with this immediate solution, we will also try to lay down the foundation of the defense production, which is also there in our manifesto. And third thing is the intention of the party and the commitment. I would like to remind you, which I think some of you will be knowing, or I think most of the people will not be knowing. BJP, when it was Jansan in 1966, has mentioned in their manifesto that if at all we get the opportunity to come into power, we will perform the nuclear explosion. It was in 1966. At the time, India has not performed 1974 explosion. Right. And after 32 years, when we came into power in 1998, we have done this in 60 days. So this was the level of commitment for defense preparedness. This is our immediate solution, and this is our long-term vision.
I think, Sudhanshu ji, I would just like to add, especially Shri Narendra Modi ji, he ensured that there is a defense university in Gujarat. And I think the party has also been emphasizing time and again on the need to have, as you said, more indigenization. And Modi ji has also mentioned quite frequently in his speeches about this.
And it is more required because we are having an hostile environment on both the sides of our boundaries. Not a very conducive history, and I'm not taking it this point against any country, but when China has started preparation of their defense equipment, India must be prepared for it.
Absolutely, I agree there. And lastly, I would like to say, Ab ki baar Modi Sarkar.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kiranji, for your question. And now we'll go on to Uttara. Uttara, can you hear me? उत्तरा जी आप मेरी आवाज सुन सकती हैं आपको अनम्यूट करना होगा
आई हैव अनम्यूटेड इट कैन यू हियर मी
आई कैन हियर यू कैन हियर मी आप एक बार फिर से उसको शायद अनम्यूट करना होगा आपको
इज इट ओके नाउ कैन यू हियर मी
जी जी मैं आपको सुन सकता हूँ आप अपना सवाल पूछिए
हाँ सुधांशु जी इट्स अ प्लेजर टू कन्वर्स विथ यू हियर आई एम अ सोशल मीडिया वॉलंटियर फॉर द बीजेपी एंड ईगरली लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड टू नरेंद्र मोदी जी माय क्वेश्चन टू यू विल बी रिगार्डिंग द मीडिया एज स्पोक्स पर्सन ऑफ द बीजेपी व्हाट इज योर एक्सपीरियंस व्हेन यू फेस अ होस्टाइल मीडिया इज द परसेप्शन ऑफ द मीडिया चेंजिंग इज द परसेप्शन ऑफ द BJP changing with the media since BJP is tipped to form the next government? Would you please elaborate on this?
As far as media is concerned, we fully respect the autonomy of media and whatever view they want to have. Yes, but we expect or we feel that there is a slightly left bias in certain sections of Indian media who enjoys in attacking BJP on even on trivial issues, but sparing our opponents even on grave issues. But still, we are not worried about that because we remain in a position for two generations. We are a party which has faced emergency 3 times, even ban on our related organizations. Still, we are the only political party in the history of India which managed to rise its stature equivalent to Congress and at the present time of time greater than Congress. So we are not worried, rather than we enjoy the opposition and the stiff opposition and the problems and the hurdles put in our way, which I would like to say in one line of Hindi, वह पथ क्या पथिक कुशलता क्या जो पथ में बिखरे शूल न हो नाविक की धैर्य परीक्षा क्या यदि धाराएं प्रतिकूल न
सुधांशु जी मैं इससे जुड़ा हुआ एक और सवाल है जो अक्सर खासकर जो लोग मीडिया के क्षेत्र से नहीं है जो आम जनता है उसके मन में होता रहता है कि क्या वाकई मीडिया की किसी भी खासकर हमने पिछले कुछ समय में देखा एक खास किस्म की पार्टी आई और उसको उभारने में मीडिया का बड़ा योगदान रहा और ये एक बड़ी आयरोनिकल सिचुएशन एक बड़ी विडंबनापूर्ण स्थिति है कि जो भाजपा के विरोधी हैं वो ये कहते हैं कि नरेंद्र मोदी जी और भाजपा को जो है वो जरूरत से ज्यादा कवरेज जो है मीडिया देता है लेकिन क्या मीडिया की क्या भूमिका क्या वाकई इतनी महत्वपूर्ण भूमिका है किसी भी राजनीतिक दल को का ग्राफ उठाने में या उसे गिराने में
देखिए मीडिया की भूमिका तो राजनीतिक दलों को बनाने और उसमें महत्वपूर्ण होती है इसमें कोई दो राय नहीं परंतु मैं इस थ्योरी को बहुत अधिक नहीं मानता कि मीडिया को कोई बहुत मैनेज कर सके ठीक है तात्कालिक दृष्टि से कुछ घटनाएं होती हैं तो मीडिया भी उसके प्रभाव में आ जाता है अगर हम ये माने कि आज मोदी जी के बारे में यदि किसी को लगता है कि मीडिया अपेक्षाकृत अधिक तवज्जो दे रहा है, तो अभी तीन महीने पहले तो एक नवोदित पार्टी को बहुत महत्व मिल रहा था। अगर दिसंबर के महीने का देखें तो शायद 80% कवरेज मिल रहा था। दो साल पहले राहुल गांधी को कवरेज मिल रहा था। तो अब इस आधार पर कि जिस समय मुझे कवरेज मिल रहा है तो मीडिया निष्पक्ष है, जब मेरे विरोधी को कवरेज मिल रहा है तो मीडिया पक्षपाती है, हम इस प्रकार की विचारधारा को पूरी तरीके से स्वीकार नहीं करते। हाँ, ये मैं मानता हूं कि मीडिया के अंदर सेक्शंस हैं, कुछ थोड़ा राइटिस्ट सोच के हैं, कुछ थोड़ा लेफ्टिस्ट सोच के हैं, और उसके अनुसार उनके अपने पूर्वाग्रह या प्रिजुडिसेस भी हैं, उनके कमिटमेंट भी, उसके अनुसार वो अपना इंटरप्रिटेशन करते हैं, उसके लिए वो पूर्णतः स्वतंत्र है, हम उनकी स्वतंत्रता का सम्मान करते हैं, भले ही हमारा उनसे मतभेद।
उत्तरा जी, थैंक्स फॉर आस्किंग द क्वेश्चन। अब हम पहुंचेंगे अगले, हमारे साथ हैं अब रंजीत। रंजीत, क्या आप मेरी आवाज सुन सकते हैं? रंजीत, आपको अनम्यूट।
या आई अनम्यूटेड, आई एम ऑडिबल।
या या, कैन यू हियर मी?
ओह या या, आई कैन हियर यू। ओके, कैन आई आस्क, Sudhanshu ji, I'm Ranjit. I'm from Bangalore. I'm a software engineer, and I've been associating with RSS since my childhood. So, my question is, now most of the countries follow capitalism, and they are in a kind of race. And as BJP socio-economic policy, it's integral humanism, it's far, far away from communism or capitalism. So in this current scenario, how can we implement integral humanism? Like, it's we are in very, we got into the depths of capitalism. How can we implement our policies that the how can we implement Deenadayal Upadhyay's great vision in the coming time? So how it is possible?
This is a very good question. The basic fundamental difference between BJP's ideology and the communist or capitalist ideology on the economic front is, in BJP's ideology of integral humanism, which was propagated by Pandit Deenadayal Upadhyay, the man is at the center, not the government is at the center. We are not going to restrict the growth of any person or other basic amenities for everybody, which is the hallmark of communist societies. In our concept, everybody is having a freedom to reach to any extent depending upon his or her capacity, but being a human, being having a faith in integral humanism, he must feel, she must feel responsibility towards the other human beings. So, it is the duty of the person or the society to take care of those who are deprived, not of the government. What today we call CSR, it has been there in practice in our society since vogue, since so many years before the vogue. I would like to ask, the government came into existence in the 60, 70 years. 100 or 200 years back, who uses to construct schools, who uses to construct ponds, dharamshalas, even roads, even trees, or so many other things, even langars and other things to poor's. It was the rich section of the society on its own, by their self-inspiration, not by the force of law. This is the basic difference that integral humanism says, that come out with the responsibility by your own inspiration from within rather than by the force of law from outside. And we are having full confidence in the cultural tradition of India, which is embedded, and the concept of integral humanism come out of that, which will be capable of not only giving a new
there was some.
To the maximum to India but also to the whole world. He is here earned. It is the ideal situation. Yani, in Hindi we can say, jo kamayega, wo khayega. That is the ideal situation. But our concept says, ye nahi ki jo kamayega, wo khayega. Jo aaya hai, wo khayega. Aur jo kamayega, wo khilayega. And it is not just an idealistical statement. It starts from the family concept of India. In Indian family, one person earns and he takes care of everybody. So this is the basic concept which starts from family, goes up to the top level, to the entire society, which is the concept of integrated humanism. And by using this, we can have equitable distribution of wealth and can solve the economic disparity.
Sudhanshu ji, what I can understand from your discourse on this issue is that BJP's economic philosophy primarily comprises of an economic model which is deeply rooted in our cultural tradition. But that also brings us to another aspect. You know, I've been getting a lot of questions on Twitter that as you have spoken a little bit about the cultural aspect. There has always been this aspect of cultural nationalism associated with BJP, and now in 21st century, what at one point of time Ram temple was one of the, you know, icon, symbolic iconic symbol of this cultural nationalism. Now how do you see, what is the importance of say Ram temple in the present context?
Actually, Ram temple was never a political issue for BJP. It was a cultural and national issue. Now I would like to explain what is the importance of Ram temple in the 21st century. We want to make India a superpower. But this is not our final target, to just make India a superpower. We want to make India a world leader in the 21st century. Because if a country wants to become superpower, the country must need the economic potential, the military potential, and the intellectual potential. But this is not enough. By virtue of that, you can become a prosperous country like Japan. But you cannot become the world leader. If you want to become the world leader, you have to have certain set of values. We go through the values which India and Indianness can exemplify the character of Ram, and Ram temple can be, you can say, an icon or a monument of those values, which I can explain you by one example. Even for those who consider Ram as a mythological character, we do not consider it. But somebody, if you consider himself as Ramayana as an imaginary thing, the entire history of the world is filled up with brother killing the other brother to sit on the throne, sons killing their fathers to sit on the throne. If in contrast to that, the ideals of Bharat having Khanau and a son like Ram is leaving the throne and going for 14 years in exile, even if it is an imaginary, you yourself can think which type of ideals can give a light for the entire world in the 21st century. In my opinion, there are two type of concept of politics. One uses to say there is no kinship in the kingship. In contrast of that, the ideal of Bharat and Ram can give a new way of light, a new set of moral values, not only to India, but to entire world, which has been termed as a clash of civilizations. So in my opinion, it is impossible for India to become world leader without Ram temple.
Now we'll move on to the next person, Pooja Kapoor. Pooja ji, aap meri awaaz sun sakti hain? Hello.
Yeah, hi, Pooja. Hi. I can hear you.
Ji, Pooja ji, aapka Google Hangout mein swagat.
Hello.
Toot gaya hai, hum
abhi. Haan, bilkul.
जी पूजा जी,
हाँ जी, हाँ जी
जी, तो आप अपने बारे में कुछ बताइए और उसके बाद आप अपना सवाल पूछिए.
हेलो सुधांशु जी, आई एम पूजा एंड आई लिव इन ग्रेटर नोएडा एंड एन आईटी प्रोफेशनल एंड दिस इज फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम आई कैंपेन फॉर बीजेपी बाय वॉलंटियरिंग एंड बाय मोबिलाइजिंग द the people here in Greater Noida. So I have a question regarding the unemployment. The entire campaign this time by Modi ji was around the youth of India. So by 2020, by year 2020, some 70% of Indians will be in the working age group. So considering that India already has some 145 million unemployed youth sitting, and the number of new jobs needed by 2020 would be around 480 million. So what would BJP do to address this very important issue of unemployment, which will take BJP, to the, 5 years is not sufficient for any government to stay and to implement policies. It is at least a decade is needed. So this is the question which I have in mind.
You have raised a very good question, because definitely for youth of India, employment is the biggest challenge. And for any government, you must have some vision and policy how to execute it. BJP is having some differences on the issues of development vis-a-vis UPA. Not only in the aspect of implementation, but in the aspect of policy. If we come into power, we will give emphasis to the infrastructure project and the manufacturing. And thirdly, of the agriculture. Because these are the three sectors which generate a lot of employment. I'm not saying that we are going against the service sector, but along with service sector, the basic intrinsic strength of economy comes out of manufacturing, infrastructure, and agriculture sector. And this I am not saying just for the sake of saying. I can give you an example. As per the Government of India's National Sample Survey data, from 1998 to 2004, when BJP or NDA government was in power, we created 60.7 million jobs, 6 crores, 7 lakh jobs in 6 years. And as per the claim of UPA government, in the last 10 years, they are able to create just 1.4 crore jobs in 10 years. And we have created 4 times jobs in 6 years. This is the example of our vision, commitment, and capability of creating more jobs. We are not having enough time. I can explain how we have created those jobs. That is a different thing.
There's just one more extension to my question, which Congress has claimed this time that they are going to have reservation in private sector. So does BJP has any stand on that? I mean, do you also agree, BJP also agrees that there should be any reservation in private sector?
On this aspect, we are not having any such proposal in front of us.
Okay.
Whenever this type of proposal comes, depending upon its merits and demerits, then BJP will decide to support stand.
I hope and I wish that BJP would be looking at the possibility of making the cake so big that everybody can have a share in it without having to reserve a certain portion of that cake for certain people.
Correct.
We do not believe in that philosophy that make the people deprived and let them fight for it. It is better to create new horizons. Like we created jobs and they have given Manrega, and that too, corruption in Manrega. This is the difference of our approach and their approach.
Thanks Pooja ji for asking such a thought provoking question, and now we will move on to BK Jha. BK Jha ji, aap meri awaaz sun sakte hain? BK Jha ji, aapko unmute karna hoga.
Kar diya, ab aap sun rahe hain meri awaaz?
जी, आपका इस गूगल हैंगआउट में स्वागत है, और आप अपने बारे में कुछ बताएं और फिर उसके बाद अपना सवाल पूछें।
धन्यवाद। नमस्कार त्रिवेदी जी।
नमस्कार।
मैं बीएच झा हूँ, मैं एक सॉफ्टवेयर इंजीनियर हूँ, और मेरी एक ई-कॉमर्स कंसल्टेंसी की कंपनी है जो कि 2004 से चल रही है, और मैं नॉर्थ ईस्ट दिल्ली कंस्टिट्यूएंसी से बिलोंग करता हूँ। मनोज तिवारी के लिए मैंने काम भी किया, प्रोफेसर रजनी अभी के लिए भी काम किया, जीटीबी नगर मंडल के आरएसएस के तरफ से मैं आईटी हेड हूँ। और मेरा क्वेश्चन आपसे है सर कि लाइक आई एम रनिंग अ वेब कंसल्टेंट कंपनी, ई कॉमर्स कंसल्टेंट, सो देयर आर नंबर ऑफ यंगस्टर हु हैव अ ग्रेट बिजनेस आइडिया रिलेटेड टू द business, but they don't get success in today's life due to the lack of government support. So what Modi ji will do for them?
For this, we just need not to have only government support. System should be transparent and efficient, so that everybody should be able to get the opportunity fairly, depending upon its talents and efforts. We will try to ensure this system, and which has been done in our state governments like Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, and Chhattisgarh.
And in that context,
no, that is only in Gujarat, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, like BJP government state. But what about all India? I'm talking about the all India. Like people are, they have a great concept. They used to come to us and they used to go to the number of consultant every day. But they don't get success because there are number of points which lack them, which back them on the point, like finance, system, taxation. There are number of points, Mr. Trivedi. So that's why they keep their concept on Almira, and that concept one day expired. So what Modi ji will do? Because Modi ji's funda is give the opportunity to businessmen so that it will create the financial growth in India. And definitely business can give the financial growth in India, because if one youngster will do job, they can earn 25,000, 1 lakh. But if one people will do the business, they can give the employ to the number of people.
Actually, we should try to unleash the potential of inherent potential of our society. Because when society gets the inherent strength, the country goes on its autopilot. It should not be dependent upon government. That's why Modi's idea is minimum government, maximum governance. And which we have tried implement even during the 6 years of NDA regime. Even if you remember, we have formed a ministry of disinvestment. So that systematically, those things which are a burden on society but having enough potential to provide economic resources and creating job opportunities for the people of India and the young people of India, they should be stripped off from the government clutches.
One question more from my side. One question, please. It's decided that Modi ji will be the Prime Minister. No one can break up ki bar Modi Sarkar. It's a sure, 100% sure. So what would be the first step of Modi ji?
On this issue, it cannot be termed as just first step. The first step will be to make the system clean and efficient.
Oh, great.
As far as possible. We are not saying that we will be able to control the file immediately after coming into power like the Congress.
Oh, that cannot be. We have seen the case.
We will initiate that process, and in a very short span of time, people will start realizing its benefits.
We have a trust on Modi ji.
जी मुझे लगता है सुधांशु जी ये जो सारी चर्चा झा साहब के सवाल पर हुई तो उसका लघु जवाब यही है कि अगर आपकी नीयत सही हो और अगर आप ईमानदारी से काम कर रहे हैं तो परिणाम निश्चित रूप से मिलेंगे
बिल्कुल
झा साहब आपको बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सवाल पूछने के लिए चर्चा में हिस्सा लेने के लिए अब हमारे साथ हैं अमित कुमार जी आप मुझे आवाज सुन सकते हैं अमित कुमार जी अभी हमारी उनसे बातचीत नहीं हो पा रही है और अब बाशव के पास हम लोग चल रहे हैं जी आप अपने बारे में कुछ बताएं और फिर उसके बाद प्लीज गो अहेड एंड आस्क योर क्वेश्चन
गुड इवनिंग सुधांशु जी मैं सिर्फ बाशव नंदी आई एम एम्प्लॉयड इन IBM एंड आई स्टे इन कोलकाता बट आई एम बेसिकली फ्रॉम कानपुर यूपी सो I don't have exactly any question, but I have certain suggestions, what I have noticed, and I think BJP and NDA can include that while facing difficult questions. First observation that I had, before 1998, that is before Atalji's government, Indians were known as snake charmers in and around the world. But after 2004, we were primarily known as technical experts. The second observation that I had is before 1998, there were means I as a student was asked to write essays on brain drain and population explosion. But when I was doing my 12th, you know, in 2005, that is after Atalji's government, we were writing essays on reverse brain drain and population as a resource, means population is a burden or a resource. So, you know, I think we should defend Atalji's tenure and NDA one government more effectively rather than giving numbers that we created these many jobs, we created that many jobs. We should say that we have brought visible change in the mindset of people. In 1998, India stood nowhere in the world, means nobody even considered India as a power. But in 2004, India was considered a power. The world stood up, took a bow, and they noticed the presence of India. But that is not the case in 2014, nor was it the case in
1998. अभी हमारे पास एक्चुअली बहुत सारे लोग हैं पंक्ति में कतार में जो पूछने के लिए चाह रहे हैं. मैं आपकी बात जो है वो समझ गया और मैं सुधांशु जी से कहूंगा कि इस पर एक त्वरित टिप्पणी एक क्विक कमेंट इस पर करें.
इन जस्ट वन लाइन आई वुड अप्रिशिएट योर व्यूज बट आई वुड लाइक टू कमेंट वन थिंग. इफ यू रिमेंबर व्हेन बराक ओबामा केम टू इंडिया एंड ही वाज एड्रेसिंग टू द जॉइंट सेशन ऑफ पार्लियामेंट द फर्स्ट सेंटेंस ही सेड इंडिया इज नॉट इमर्जिंग इंडिया हैज इमर्ज्ड. From where the emergence of India started? It started on 13th of May 1998 when India performed the nuclear test. So it started with the NDA regime under Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And now in 2014 a gloomy picture has been depicted all over the world, and it is said that during NDA regime it was said that it is an Indian success story. Now it is said it seems that Indian success story is over. I can assure you that Indian success story is not over, it is waiting for BJP to come into power.
Thank you, Bashab, for making these very valuable observations. And now we have a question from Twitter. Sudhanshu ji, you have been going to various television programs very regularly, and there have been a lot of surveys. So, what do you think? Would you like to, you know, this is actually, you know, top of the town that how many seats BJP is going to get. So what's, would you like to share some observations? What's the kind of thinking which is going on in the party? Because we are almost like kind of halfway through in the elections. A little bit, I think probably more than that. And a lot of seats have gone into elections where BJP has a strong presence. So would you like to kind of share some observations on this?
As far as surveys are concerned, in such a vast and complicated country like India, I cannot say that any survey agency can depict exact or almost exact number of seats. Yes, they can show you a trend. So the trend is clearly saying that there is a strong wave in favor of BJP under the leadership of Narendra Modi, and we are far, far ahead of Congress. Congress is far flung number two. And if you look at the results of the last 7 or 8 years of various state assembly elections, people has followed the trend and given a decisive mandate in favor of one party or the other. I'm not saying whether it has gone in favor of us or against. Like in Karnataka 2008, we were not expecting that we are going to get the clear majority. In the same manner in Karnataka, which has gone for poll today, we were not expecting that we will get just 40 seats. But the people has given it one way or the other. In Delhi, Aam Aadmi Party state assembly election getting 28 seats was an indicator of this. So in my opinion, the mood of the country is gradually shifting from fractured mandate of late 90s and early 2000 to a clear cut decisive mandate, and I hope that in 2014 the country will give a decisive clear cut mandate for a strong government of BJP under the leadership of Shri Narendra Modi.
I think we have one more caller. It's Sachin. Sachin, aap meri awaaz sun sakte hain?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Sachin, first I must thank you for being so patient. and being there. आपका स्वागत करता हूँ Google Hangout में. आप तो अपने बारे में कुछ पंक्तियाँ कहें और उसके बाद please go ahead and ask the question.
Hello Sudhanshu ji, I am Sachin Gupta and I am from Pandam Nagar, East Delhi. And I am an IT professional and I have my own IT firm in Noida and associated with Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh from last 18 years. Sir, as we saw in Delhi elections, Delhi Assembly elections, so many youth voted for Aam Aadmi Party. And after 49 days, Aam Aadmi Party could not run the government. In this case, jaise hum kehte hain ki janta ne bahut thaga hua mehsoos kiya. So my question is a vote for Aam Aadmi Party a wasted vote, and why is the BJP the best party to lead India?
The question which you have asked is a long time to answer, but I would like to contain it in few minutes. BJP, any political party, you can judge it on three parameters. Number one, its policy. Number two is organizational capacity, its structure, and third is leadership. Niti, Sangathan, aur Netritva. In three muddon ke aadhar pe aap kisi bhi rajnitik dal ki samiksha kar sakte. And if you look, BJP and which type of thought it is proven. Third, fourth thing, ideology kya hai, vichardhara kya hai. Agar aap us nazariye se dekhen, BJP is the only political party in the history of India which in its entire history of 63 years from Janasangh to BJP is have not seen any vertical division. So we are a party with a difference. We have created stalwart leaders like Deen Dayal Upadhyay in 60s, Atal Bihari Vajpayee in 80s, 70s and 80s, extremely popular leaders. Advani ji, and today Narendra Modi. Has any political party had the structure and mechanism to create this type of senior leaders? Second thing, despite being in power for so long in so many states and remaining in power at center in 6 years, I'm not saying that we are absolutely clean, but by any parameter, we are much, much more better in terms of corruption and efficient management. And on the aspect of ideology, it deals whether it is a matter of national security, national pride, external security or internal security, BJP's stand is much more clear, categorical and nationalist. So by any parameter, we are having different. Unlike the parties, some emerging parties like Aam Aadmi Party, most of the people who are youth, but with due respect to you people, since I also represent the same category in politics, but I would say that in a such a complex country like it, I'm saying complex with full responsibility, the young leadership experiences were not very fruitful. Who is the youngest chief minister of the country right now? Akhilesh Yadav. What is happening in UP? Who is the second youngest? Umar Abdullah. What is happening there? Who was the youngest prime minister? Rajiv Gandhi at the age of 40, he became prime minister of India and he got biggest ever majority in the history. And ultimately he took Congress in 1989 to such a situation that even after 25 years, they are unable to get a simple majority. And who was the most powerful youngest politician in the entire history of India? It was Sanjay Gandhi at the age of 30 during emergency, was de facto prime minister. And it was Sanjay Gandhi who led to disaster of Congress in 1937. So what I am trying to say, anything which emerges quickly, which is not symbolizing an organic growth, must be seen with a proper caution. It's like a painkiller which can give you a short-term immediate relief, but cannot be a decisive permanent remedy. It can be only through a systematic discipline and a long-term remedical solution.
I think Sudhanshu ji, you have made a very valid point. I think the short-term painkillers, these painkillers in short-term, they give you relief and they also give you a lot of side effects, you know, in the long run. So, there is one very interesting question from Aditya on Twitter. He has asked, what is BJP planning to do about the revival of or for increasing the popularity of Sanskrit language?
This is a very, very peculiar question. But on the issue of language, any language must have three components, or you can say three factors for any language. Number one, how scientific it is. Number two, how practical it is. Means connectivity, whether it is able to be used as a lingua franca. And third, every language emerges out of a culture. Which type of cultural and value system this language is promoting? If you look, Sanskrit is a basic core connecting link between various Indian languages. If you know Sanskrit, you can easily connect to so many words in so many languages. Like in Gujarati, you say Jetha. It is a word of Sanskrit word. Jetha means bada. In Marathi, in Hindi we say Aspatal. In Marathi we say Rugnale. Rugna means Rogi, which is a Sanskrit word. You can easily connect to Rugna. In Bengali you say Jal. In Hindi you say Pani, but you can easily understand Jal. In Kannada, you say Ladka, Ladki, Balak, Balika. Balak, Balika is a Sanskrit word. So if you know Sanskrit, you can easily connect to it. Now come to the scientific aspect of language. Sanskrit or any other Indian language like Hindi. I can give you one example. In your childhood, you would have heard ka, kha, ga, gha, anga. When you say ka, the pressure is on the front part of your mouth. When you say kha, it goes backward. When you say ga, it goes further backward. When it goes gha, further backward, and anga comes from the bottom of your throat. It means the entire phonetic is designed as per the phonetic chord. That's why people used to say the Sanskrit is the most capable language for computers. And in every language, you would have seen a problem of accent. A North Indian Punjabi is speaking another accent, and a Bihari is speaking another accent, and a Malayalam and Tamil is speaking another accent, and in various parts of the world. But in Sanskrit, whether you go to Vaishno Devi or to go to Tirupati, when priest is chanting the mantras, have you ever seen a difference? This is the capability of the language. Scientific aspect of language, there is no problem of accent in Sanskrit. And lastly, a set of values. When you write a letter to your father in English, what do you write? Hello Dad. Or Dear Father. Respected father is not an English word. It is the Indian version of English. The pure English word is Dear Father or Respected Father. In Sanskrit, if you write to your father, you will write Pujya Pitaji Sadar Charan Sparsh. There is a huge difference in calling your father as Dear Father or Hi Dad and Pujya Pitaji Sadar Charan Sparsh. This is the set of values. In my opinion, in the last 50-60 years, so many things of Indian society and the great heritage and wisdom of India, which was ridiculed, has been accepted by the world. Like in 50-60s, they used to say, when we used to say like, respect trees, respect rivers, respect mountains, then we were ridiculed that this is the reminiscence of a primitive tribal civilization. Now, just after 50 years, from 1992 Rio de Janeiro to 2009 Copenhagen, you are saying, go for the nature friendly development. In 50-60s, you used to say, ridicule the Ayurveda. Hey, what happens with these type of leaves and petals? Go for metacin, teramycin, soframycin, other things. Now you are saying, go to herbal medicine. In 50-60s, you say that how can you have a farming with a cow dung? The people have reached to moon and still you are sitting on cow dung. Go for mechanized farming, chemical fertilizer. Now you are saying, go for organic farming. Now, previously you used to say, reduce vegetarianism. Arey, khas khus khane se koi taqat aati hai. But you are saying today, predominantly vegetarian. And on this aspect, I would like to give you one point. You read the Newsweek article in August 2009, written by Lisa Miller, how these things are getting affected or affecting the American population. So just my conclusion is, as all those things have gradually come to the knowledge of modern world and they have started accepting on the issue of language, definitely in the coming time they will accept the scientific aspect of Indian language, and of course the mother of all the Indian languages and most of the languages of the world is Sanskrit. And we will try to support this movement based on scientific rational aspect.
Sudhanshu ji, thanks for such an informative comment. और आप Google Hangout में आए, आपने इतना समय जो है यहाँ पर दिया और सब लोगों से चर्चा की, और सबसे बढ़कर जिन लोगों ने भी इसमें हिस्सा लिया, हम बहुत से सवाल ट्विटर पर फेसबुक पर थे जो कि समय की कमी होने के कारण ले नहीं पा रहे हैं. अगले Google Hangout में निश्चित रूप से हम प्रयास करेंगे कि इन सवालों को लिया जा सके, और हम आशा करते हैं कि भारत में जो है श्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी के नेतृत्व में जो है एक सबल सरकार आएगी जो कि भारत का पुनः नव निर्माण करेगी. आप इस Google Hangout में आए, आपको बहुत